give your normal welcome to Gary, please. All right, are we switched on to this? Right, okay. Let me thank everyone today for your interest in the Samtampa. It's very nice to see such a large crowd. And before I start, I would like to say I'm indebted to both Jeff and Lawrence as my technical managers. Without them, I'm not too sure what I'd be doing. And also to my wife, Jeanette, who, having forgot my glasses, has come to my rescue, and I've now got a set of glasses that I can use as well. So with that, I'll make apologies that I'll sit down because my wobbly knee will not stand up all the through the show here, and I'll proceed. Equipment being good with the talk. What I've tried to do is to put a number of stories together. This is not just the demise of the Samtampa. It's what came before the Samtampa and what's coming after the Samtampa, but hopefully we can weave them into one story. A lot of people don't realize that this is the only battle that started on the first day of the war and carried on until the day after the war, actually, with one U-boat captain, a young lad in charge of a U-boat, actually torpedoed a ship the day on the 9th of May. The war finished in on the 8th of May, 1945. It was the only battle that Churchill was worried about, he admitted, and it started within 6 hours of war being declared on September the 3rd, with the loss of the Athena passenger ship. It was the largest by far, and the longest by far, and the most important by far, battle of World War II. 32,000 UK merchant seamen died. They weren't in the services, they were just employed as civilians. And of course, I think most people are aware that their pay stopped the minute they got sunk. The ship sunk in the middle of the Atlantic. They were in a boat maybe for 30 or 40 days, hoping to be rescued with no pay. So yes, it does. The total, there's an awful lot of statistics when you get involved with this, and some of them don't always add up exactly, but generalising the bottom there, there was 3,500 merchant ships sunk, 175 warships, and 783 U-boats were sunk in, this is just the Battle of the Atlantic. As I've said, within 6 hours of war being declared, a large 13,500 ton liner was sunk with a loss of 128 lives. And this picture, that's not the Athena, that's just a large ship which is representing the ship. It was in fact bigger than what you see there. And some of those who lost their lives were Americans as well as British. This was the normal format. You can see that this particular ship has already had a torpedo in the bows on the right-hand side and is sinking that. And for good luck, it's given one in the stern as well. And amazingly, in the 4 months when really everybody was just thinking, what's this war about? 200 and plus ships were sunk. And they were sunk, obviously, with full cargoes. Which is not always appreciated. And if, I think that's a life raft there, just in the spot there, but you can see the sea's pretty calm there, what you were faced with. And it was fairly obvious that the German strategy was to starve Britain, not only of food, but also of industrial its might. And we would have had to surrender. There would be no ifs and buts about it. And had the North Atlantic lifeline been cut, there were, in fact, nearly 200 convoy routes, but obviously the main ones were from Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, and up the western side of Africa, and of course the Atlantic one, which is Canada, America, the Caribbean, South America, and obviously ships from the Pacific also used that route coming through the Panama Canal. Now, this is just purely an interest situation, which I'll try and read for those that can't read it. The result of the German efforts to sink the ships bringing food to the UK resulted in rationing for 14 years and a dig for victory program. So a lot of tennis courts, parks, all sorts of greenery bits were dug up for potatoes and cabbages in particular. In 1939, we imported 20 million tons of food per year, which was 50% of our meat, 70% of our cheese, sugar, cereals, and fats, and so on. And the illustration on the right here is one adult's food rationing for a week. You could grow as much as you like, that didn't include it, obviously, but it included one egg, a shilling's worth of meat, 4 ounces of bacon or four rashers, 2 ounces of butter, 8 ounces of sugar, 2 pints, and sometimes, because it fluctuated with what was coming in on the ships, it did fluctuate, so about 2 or 3 pints of milk, loose tea was 2 ounces, and cheese was 2 ounces. So it was a fairly meagre ration, which confronted people. And what amazes people in hindsight is that it went on till 1954. And most people are so used to filling their cars up with petrol or whatever, but petrol came back in 1945 in rationing form, because there was no petrol for the public during the war, and it was abandoned altogether in 1954. So this one here shows from South Africa, I think it's whale steak casserole. The long queues, everybody was out all day trying to get a loaf of bread from a queue or something or other. And this is a pictorial view of what a weekly ration looked like. I've got some details on rationing, a bit more detail out front if anybody wants to have a look at it afterwards. So, how did that leave the UK? Well, Churchill realised fairly quickly, and everybody else in authority, that we couldn't go on losing 200 ships every 4 months or whatever. Although Britain started the war with by far the largest merchant navy in the world, we were probably 60% of all the ships in the world trading and taking cargoes were British. But having said that, at the outbreak of war, Germany had by far the largest fleet of submarines. And prior to that, the outbreak of war, the 10 years previous to that, Germany, in secret and sometimes not so secret, been planning and designing war machines from airplanes to U-boats. And I think we were very comfortable with our head in the sands just thinking about it at the time. So when September the 3rd came along, we were really caught napping, and the Churchill and his staff sent a mission to America and said, can we buy some ships off you desperately? We don't want the quality, we want the quantity. That's the important feature. And would you? And of course, the Americans were out, not in the war, for another two plus years. And so they were very happy to sell us their goods. And the three fellows that went, in fact, to Washington had a brief for the ship they wanted to buy, and it was 10,000 tons. It was 7,000 tons, 10,000 of carrying cargo capacity, and would do 11 or 12 knots. And that was the brief. And surprise to them all, the Americans had no designs for such a ship. So, but they were building one in Tyneside, where these people are from. One guy was the chairman of the company, and he had in his briefcase a full set of plans and said, there we are, can you build that for us? And the order was placed for 60 ships. And the Americans have a very novel attitude to certain things, and people who had never built a ship before volunteered to build it 60 ships. And they were civil engineers, and they actually did it. But what it started was America's miracle of mass production, applying it to shipyards. They didn't want, they just went out and they said, here we are, there's so many acres there, build a slipway and build a ship around the slipway. It was totally different to anything that had been used in the past. And the other novel thing about it was they would sub-assemble it. So they'd build it in modular pieces and far away from the shipyard itself, then they put it on some big lorries and they would ship it to the shipyard and just weld the modules together. And that's an engine being delivered to one of the slipways. The weight of the engine is 120 tons, but it's already sealed up. And one thing to mention about the engine was it was an obsolete engine. It was actually first designed in Scotland in something like 1880. But it was a very reliable engine, and it didn't use the materials which the Americans wanted for warship production. All the clever stuff had to go to the military. So what they wanted was a very basic ship that would plod along with a big cargo, and so they appointed that engine there to go into it. You can see in the background here, there's the hull of the ship, and this piece here is nicely going to be welded to that piece there. And of course, whereas today it's common sense, shall we call it, in those days this was groundbreaking, really, building a big piece of the ship and then sending it 40, 50 miles and sticking it all together as such. Another new, not invention, but another new thing was women were being used quite surprisingly as riveters in the aircraft industry, and they were replacing people that on the expansion side, but they couldn't rivet steel places. They just weren't I wouldn't say man enough, but they certainly weren't strong enough to weld steel plates together, rivet steel plates together. But they could weld, and so there was quite this new piece of, it wasn't the first welded ships, their welded ships had been tried in the odd ones and twos, but this was, the whole program was going over to welding ships, and women could do it equally as well as men. This gives you a fairly good situation of the Liberty ship assembled in little over 3 weeks at one yard, and in 5 days in one case, which was a bit of a promotion thing. But all they did was take a waste piece of land, they would bulldoze it into the slipways here, then they'd have the sub-assembly yards behind it, and then they would fit it out once it had been launched into the water, would be here, and it was all done at a huge rate of knots, which nobody had ever envisaged before. This is a fantastic aerial picture of the Kaiser shipyards. This is the guy who would only build dams and houses, and said, yeah, you want 60 ships? I'll build you 60 ships. And you can see all these berths side by side by side by side, all sloping down to the water. And in this particular ship here that's being launched, there's the workers, and they all had an hour off for the launching of their particular ship, which averaged 3 or 4 weeks normally. The growth in the American merchant fleet is shown there from 1942, because it was Christmas 41 that obviously Japan attacked them on their day of infamy, and that was their capacity. And within 3.5 years, they'd got five times larger. I mean, it's almost impossible to think of the scale of production that they had. And this one is the USSR Victory, so that was obviously going to Russia, because that was the fitting out bays, rows of them. And that's what they ended up with. That's a bulk standard 7,210 armed Liberty ship. There's guns on the stern and on the bows there, and there was anti-aircraft guns on both sides of the deck. And it could carry 10,000 tons, and often it carried a lot more than 10,000 tons. on the day that America got attacked by Japan, the president ordered all car factories to stop production, to finish what they were doing, and turn themselves over to manufacturing tanks, lorries, all sorts of things. And I think there was there is a figure like 15 cars were made between the outbreak of war with Japan and, of course, Germany then, to the end of the war. Back on that one, that is the Samtampa. It's not the Samtampa, but it's the same ship. The convoy structure itself was an amazing story. That's around 50 ships being prepared to leave Halifax, Nova Scotia, which was the main part. New York, once the Americans came into the war, New York became a very big player as well. But the routing of the ships meant that a lot actually started or whatever in Halifax and moved on. And you must remember that these ships, there was two convoys. One was prefix, they all had prefixes as to where they were coming from and going to. And they had two types of convoys. There was the slow convoy and the fast convoy. The slow convoy was 7 knots, so that's just over 7 miles an hour. And the fast convoy was 9 to 10 knots. And you've got 3,000 miles to go, and there's loads of U-boats waiting for you to come. So it wasn't very appetizing, but a lot of people forget, really, at times the war was canceled temporarily because of the weather, and a lot of these ships ended up getting severely damaged, basically in the weather. And the convoy escorts, because I've only talked about the merchant ships, really, but there were escorts as well with these. And the planning was that they, once they got to the other side, whichever side, they had 3 days off. But if you met a storm like that, you got there 3 days late. So you had to turn around, and the plans were for you to go back across, which wasn't very appetizing. The result, many ships, and it surprises me how many Atlantic ships crossing the Atlantic were torpedoed, didn't sink, and they either towed the two halves back and welded them back together, or they towed the one piece back, and if the other piece had sunk. When you read what happened, it is amazing. But having said that, there was also a question arose over the quality of welding ships together, because they were, on occasion, ships did break up and showed serious signs of breaking up in bad weather, purely from the construction point of view. And they gradually worked on this during the war, and whereas the deck, loading decks, you were square apertures, a bit like the Comet aircraft, square corners are not a good idea in engineering terms. Stress is a weak stress point there. And so what they did was they cut radiuses in all the deck holes and reinforced the deck along here, and that took care of a lot of weaknesses that was in the first ships that came. Before going through that, I would tell you that the Royal Navy was caught in no man's land, basically. They'd had 20 years since the First World War. The Navy had a lot of experience with U-boats in the First World War, and they adopted the convoy side, which is really, really efficient. A lot less ships get sunk in the convoy. But they spent the next 20 years thinking of battleships and all sorts of things, and never applied any thoughts really to submarine warfare and beneath the sea. So when the advent of the first convoys in the first year was going to and fro, they had this and it's a human quality, I think, of objective escorts, in so much that they run up and down the convoy route looking for U-boats in an aggressive manner to try and find them. But of course, the U-boats, if they saw coal, steam on the horizon, they'd just sink and let it go past. And then when the convoy came up, play havoc with the convoy itself. And it obviously didn't work. There's a great similarity if you're interested in Bomber Command, whereas none of the fighters wanted to escort slow-moving bombers. They just wanted to patrol all the way around and whatever. And it was the same with this. The destroyers and the various ships didn't want to stay with the convoy. And it had to be proved by 18 months of very poor results that, hang on, if you stay with the convoy, the submarines are after the convoy, so they're going to come to you rather than you try and find them. And that's eventually what percolated out, that the Royal Navy then found, and there was a very famous captain called Johnny Walker, and he perfected the system of how to protect not only the convoy with a close escort, but with an outlying escort as well. They could go charging off looking for submarines, but the inner ones would stay with the convoy. And so we really were losing everything we touched, not only at sea, on the land as well, up until the advent of 43. And in March 43, Germany's much larger U-boats were then entering. They were having these sort of tanker U-boats that would fill up the normal U-boats with submarines and fuel, and everything they thought was going really their way. And the Wolf packs were now being deployed in 40 numbers of 40, so that the convoy system was had air cover 1,000 miles from America or Canada, and it had 1,000 miles cover from the UK. But being 3,000 miles, there was a piece in the middle, 1,000 miles wide, where the U-boats just used to, and they would put 12 U-boats there, the convoy passed, they would try and surface inside the convoy during the night, because U-boats are quite fast in comparison to merchant ships, and they thought this was really going their way. And the book I'm reading now is about the HX-229, and SC-122, they sank 22 ships in that convoy of just over 100 ships in 5 days, with the loss of one U-boat, and they were pretty jubilant about it. They couldn't sustain that amount of activity, so they had to go and refuel and rearm and change crews and whatever. So April was a quiet month, but May saw what the Germans didn't expect. Was that the UK, a lot of things that that was happening technically were coming to happen. There was new longer range aircraft, which was the B-25, the Mitchell bomber, that could, there was far better surface weapons and underwater detection improved, because the question of radar at night, they could see a U-boat in surface in the darkness and like inside the convoy. But with the advent of the radar that was taking place, they could now find it and go and get it. The mass production of the Liberty ship was coming really into full gear. Once the Americans, the Japanese had attacked the Americans in the end of 41, they really went in top gear. And the British effort was small in comparison by then. They pulled out all the stops, and they were building Liberty ships quicker than the U-boats could sink them, which was a real mark. And in May they saw 34 ships sunk for the loss of 18 U-boats. So all of a sudden the equation was coming together. And the Admiral Dönitz never really had the supremacy from May 43. It was a bit of a downward curve from there on. But besides wolf packs of U-boats, there was also a lot of mines left around the place. There was the aircraft attacks, there was surface raiders, and of course the Atlantic storms all had its effect on boats. And these are two 17-year-old lads, survivors, covered in oil, which has got, when you think of the Samtampa situation, how do you see people like that in the sea? You know, it's a bit of luck more than judgment. But Liberty ships supplying the army was a risky business, and you can see all those shells in the hull of a Liberty ship there, and sometimes things went wrong, and there would be no survivors from an ammunition. They were paid extras, like merchant seamen on tankers were paid extras. I've won an awful lot extra myself. and that's another ammunition ship blowing up, and again, no survivors as such. And it all had to come to an end at some stage, with the end of the war. By that time, the Americans had built 2,700 Liberty ships. There were permutations on Liberty ships for special ships and whatever. And under their emergency program, they'd built 6,000. And once the war had ended, there was an awful lot of ships that didn't have anywhere to go. And you can see that was a very common sight in North America. That's another river, 1954, still parked there waiting for somebody to buy them. And that came to an end, was the world's greatest building program. Nothing could envisage today the building program that had gone before. There are two Liberty ships still in existence. This one is on the west coast in San Francisco, and this is the one in Baltimore on the east coast. And the strange thing that when the celebration for 50 years or whatever was done of D-Day, both ships were invited to Normandy. And this one, obviously, being on the near side, you would have thought would have made it, but actually it broke down mid-Atlantic and had to return. The other one came all the way, actually visited London as well. And then we come on to the Samtampa itself. And I spent some time at the National Archives recently, and surprised how much information I got, actually. I was trying to get the ship's movements. It was three years old and four months when it crashed on the rocks in Porthcawl. And I wanted to try and find out where it had been during those 3 years. And I've got still some work to do, but I think we've about mastered exactly each of its convoy duties. It took place in 16 convoys. It did an awful lot of sailing independently, which was much safer, obviously, once 44 had come along. And it in one convoy, which was HX-304, which is from Halifax, it was the Commodore's ship of choice. And so he ran the convoy from Samtampa. And in each convoy, and I'll just read you some of the details on it. This was Depart New York, 17th of August, 1944, and arrived Liverpool, 1st of September, 1944. And it shows there was 87 merchant ships in the convoy, 27 escort vessels, and the Commodore for the merchant ships was aboard the Samtampa. In such a convoy, there is a Commodore for the escort vessels, so the Royal Navy were totally separate to the merchant ships. They obviously had meetings prior to the convoy for the captains, and everybody knew what they were expected to do, because there was originally an awful lot of zigzagging as well. And if you can imagine 80 ships in the middle of the night trying to zigzag amongst themselves, it did cause problems. But there was radio silence, because the Germans were monitoring all transmissions. Unfortunately, in this particular period of 43, Bletchley, the Germans had added another wheel to their Enigma machine, and Bletchley Park was unable to read their signals for something like 10 months, and of course that's when maximum damage is done. But going back to the convoy, so the Royal Navy protecting these ships were totally separate and did not communicate in general with any convoy. The Commodore on the merchant ships ran the convoy itself. And that's what happened sometime later in Porthcawl here, and the tragedy of both vessels. That's the looking from the sea. Working this out, if you look at this, well, the bows here are pointing inland, so you can see that the bows there are pointing inland. So this picture was taken from the shoreline, and this must have been taken very quickly afterwards, because it's still a high tide running, and you know, whether it was the next tide 12 hours later or what, I don't know. But so there's the midships part caught, because this is the actual coastline here, and this is the rocky plateau, which, if you know the area, it's washed up. And there is a gully in this area here, as such. I don't know what I put there, but the Samtampa was laid down in November 43, and it took about 6 weeks to build it, and it was launched on December the 9th. It had sea trials and handed over to the Ministry of War Transport, which later on became the Ministry of Transport, but during the war it was called War Transport. On the 23rd of December, the minute it sailed for New York, and 2 days later, Christmas Day, it was in New York. Its first convoy, which I've got records of here, it was from Hamilton Roads, Virginia, in January the 25th, 1944, and it did an awful lot of work to the North African coast and the Mediterranean area for some reason. But of course, the Americans had landed in the North African campaign at that time as well. I should explain this part here, Pierre Wadsworth. A lot of these ships being built because the Americans wanted as much money as they could from the people, and so very rich people used to pay the $2 million or whatever it was for a ship in those days. Bear in mind, there was $4 to the pound. But the Ministry of War Transport took was put in front, and so these people lost their ships. They were given another ship much later on, which didn't go down to the very rich people of New York and sometimes. The ship was bound. Why was it in Porthcawl? Well, it was in the Bristol Channel because it was going to Newport for what we would think of as an MOT for our car. In fact, it was the sale had been agreed with the Alexander Shipping Company in Cardiff for £135,000, and as long as it was watertight, there was no damage underneath, the dry dock in Newport was going to look at that, then it would have been part of Cardiff Shipping Company fairly quickly. It sailed down from Middlesbrough and to the east coast of England and the south coast, and it got within the Bristol Channel fairly. And unfortunately, that particular winter was very serious winter with gales and snow and all sorts of things, and 30-foot waves. The serious problem it seemed to have was in confronting the weather, because the captain presumably turned the ship into the weather and what was called hove to. And hove to is running the ship at whatever speed is necessary to stay in the same place, basically. And the problem I would be fairly sure that he had was that he was extremely light in ballast, so the ship was really high in the water. And the wind, obviously, it can get hold of it, and that's a weakness if you can't sort of bed down in the water. It was also a mariner's nightmare that it was confined by land, which wasn't very far away, and it also had both bow anchors down. These ships didn't have stern anchors, they only had bow anchors, and if you put your both bow anchors down, you pull the bow into the water. So if you've got a big swell running under the ship, it lifts the ship, it's held on the front end, so So the back end rises up and the propeller comes out of the water. It has very little traction in those situations. And so it's a difficult scenario that he was caught in. The inquiry, the public inquiry that took place, said the ship became unmanageable. It didn't appoint any blame to anyone. And it had bad luck right to the end, because people who know the area, there's Rest Bay, there's Sandy Bay outside, there's all these bays around you, and there's more of a beach. And it was 100 yards or so from more of a beach. And had he, I don't think he could have really, because of his anchors down, and I suggest that they got snagged on the rocks at Scare Point, which didn't allow the ship to get to more of the sands. Had it landed on more of a, they would have been a much easier ride for everybody. Unfortunately, some of the papers on the day, there's an awful lot of publicity from the day, which is still carried on, and good journalists, if they can't get the facts, then they put a couple in, which they think is just about right. And this carried, if you go on the internet today, that still carries on. The Samtampa registered in London and the Ministry of War. South Wales Police were taken, obviously, off the bodies. Not all were found on the same day. And as probably most of you will know, 12 remain in Porthcawl, including one of the young members of the crew, because the crew was made up. It was a young crew taken on in Middlesbrough and that area, which is Whitby, Cleveland, and there were two 17-year-old lads on the ship. There was one 18-year-old, and there were five 19-year-olds on the ship. And I think one of those is still in the cemetery in Porthcawl with the other 11. And Shout is going to soon clean up the grave, ready for the anniversary next year. That's the engine and you can see two people here. I'm not too sure which one of those two still in existence. There's a man there with his white hat on, leaning over there, and there's somebody sitting on the chair here. But that gives you a good indication of just how little room there is in a normal engine room. That's it. I was in my son's in Auckland, and they've got a very good transport museum, and that engine is in there in one or two sizes, because they scaled it up and scaled it down. It was a most reliable engine. And that's what's left of it today. If you go out on a low tide, that's what you see at Scare Point today. There's not an awful lot left of it as such. You can see the engine there, and there's anchor chain coming across. The anchor chain is draped all over the rocks there, and on the table there's one of the anchor links, which I've got if anybody wants to see it, because there is a query which nobody can solve, which is the design of the anchor link. And I've asked loads of people, but nobody has come up with an answer yet. That's the link that's on the desk there, and you can see it's a serrated edge there, which looks like a safety feature. But why would you have a safety feature in an anchor chain? As you can see, that style there is quite different. So, I don't know. Moving on to the Edward Prince of Wales. We call it the Samtampa disaster, but it's only an abbreviated form, because Edward Prince of Wales is quite a mouthful. This was a very, very successful lifeboat built in, the series was built in the Isle of Wight, and this one was built in 1924. It was 45 foot long, and it had a single screw 80 horsepower engine, and was due to be replaced the year before. But anybody who can remember the wartime, there were shortages for an awful long time after the war, and therefore the replacement hadn't arrived when the Samtampa arrived. It was an open boat, there was no cabin for the crew, and all communication, there was no radio on board, had to be done by a signalling lamp, which is a visual Morse code employed by the navies. There was a very experienced crew because the and the leader had a gold medal awarded for rescuing a torpedoed Canadian ship, similar to Samtampa a year or two earlier. But the Samtampa didn't really call for help or any serious assistance and lost an hour or two, a valuable hour or two. So by the time, they weren't to know it in Swansea, but by the time they were launching the lifeboat at 6 o'clock, the ship was already on the rocks in Porthcawl, and there's no way that I know that you can launch a rescue when one side of the ship is on the rocks and the other side is on the sea. The normal rescue is to get round the lee side of the ship, which is so the ship takes the rudder off on the one side and the rescue can take place on the other side. This is just another part of the press that was on. This was about the only good picture on the internet that I could find of the Mumbler's boat. It was a Watson class 45 being for the length of it, and it cost £12,800 as new. That was the Mumbler's crew, and that was the gold medal winner, William Gammon. But it wasn't that wasn't the crew that went to the Samtampa's rescue. That was the ship that I was telling you, a Canadian ship, which they rescued some years earlier. The Mumbler's lifeboat, the Edward Prince of Wales, was found. Nobody saw it. No living person actually witnessed it at the scene until the following morning, when it was found close by and upturned. All the crew were buried together in Mumbles, and I've had some interesting people ring me. It was my father, was the mechanic. I put the story in the Western Mail, and somebody in Carmarthen read the story, who sent it to his friend in Northampton, and he was orphaned. His father was the mechanic on the lifeboat when he was 4.5 years old, and so I got to know John quite well since then. There was a big investigation, as you would expect, and then, following tradition from the RNLI, the boat was burnt where it was found at Sker. And that is where the memorial today is, and that's the memorial there. It's the second memorial. The first one was washed away because these big rocks, when we do get equinox tides and whatever, these big rocks move around. You wouldn't think so, but they do. There's the rest back there. So if you want to go and see the memorial, it's quite a hike. And then on top of that, you've got to find it. And unless you know where it is, somebody takes you, there's not a great chance that you will find. That's the memorial there. And there's Mumbles across there. So looking west or looking east, it's not an easy thing to find. You can be within 50 yards of it, and you come away not finding it. We had a Remember the Samtampa for people who do remember as children, the event, and ITV came down and recorded it all. The recording is lodged in Aberystwyth Library, and we've had a copy of it. There's Jeff Sons at the back there. All these people here were standing up, one after the other, and changing over, telling us. I think this guy here was an ex-sea captain himself, and he was a cadet, and his tanker, he was on a BP tanker, and they sheltered in Lundy and wouldn't proceed past Lundy because of the storm. We gave approaches to Neath for Talbot College and to Bridgend College, and both were very enthusiastic in taking us up on trying to get involved the students with a real life promotion. These are obviously the art students, and so we did a smaller version of what you're seeing now for them to know what a Liberty ship was. They'd never heard of it. Everything was totally unknown to them, and they really took it on board. And sort of a couple of months later, we went back and they presented their work. Some of their work is on the front again, outside here. And this young man had a very good idea. On his memorial there, he's put black graphite or black granite, and that was to signify how everybody died, because nobody drowned. Of the 47 people on the two vessels, no one actually drowned. They all died of asphyxiation, of being immersed in thick oil, and it blocked just instantly all your airways. He put that in, which we've carried that idea forward as well. I've only put two slides here, but we had some very interesting times. Everybody in the college, this is Bridgend College, was enthusiastic, and they really would like to do more with it. Looking for a memorial, we were in Belgium on one of these D-Day landing holidays, and I saw that. I've never known what it is. I've asked loads of people, what is it? Nobody seems to know. But it gave the idea that, which I'd seen years and years previously, for a memorial. And it also blends in very often with pictures you see at Porthcawl, whereas the weather arches over everything. And of course, there's that very famous Japanese painting, which I think is around 200 years old. I won't try and pronounce who the artist was, but it really is Mount Fuji in the background there, and this is the local sailing fleet going out, and this is the hazards they meet as fishermen. And of course, those symbols did somebody at the Prince of Wales pub, who is an exhibition designer, came up with that idea, which is following showing some of those things, which BCBC didn't think was very good, which wouldn't surprise us, but we thought it had sort of mileage to look at. And at the same time, when we were on this Battle of the Bulge short holiday, again in Belgium, this was an artist's idea where he had a piece of stone, and it unearthed, in this particular case, a rather smart looking lady, but we were thinking more of a ship or parts of a ship. And so that idea did the rounds in the colleges and whatever. And we also left them with a brief, even if it was just a geometric something or other with inlay or whatever. And so we didn't want to guide them too much. We just wanted to give them some ideas of where they could think of or where. And mosaics, it can tell a story with mosaics, but it might have a limited life, I don't know. But so that's me finished. Well, more or less, because I've left the actual finish to this part. And we've been negotiating with BCBC for forever, as there's this very large, there's the RNLI station, there's the lighthouse, which you see on every library pictures on any storm in the UK these days. And that's the watchtower, which has recently been commissioned. And you've got this very, very large area here, which they think is crowded. And we thought it would be very nice to put a memorial down there, because if you go back, if you look from there this way, he's looking west to Mumbles, which would be very symbolic, we thought. But it's not our land, it's their land, and we've tried to sort of say, look, well, give us some indication. You've got the bait shop here. There's a very nice piece out of the way around that area there. There's this wall area here. There's the footprint of that, which is our latest version. It's only a metre by 3 metres, so it's a public bench and a half. That's all it is. We've said it can be scaled down, it can be this, it can be that, but they have no interest. The piece I was telling you about, the young lad in artist in Bridgen, that's the black granite base to signify the oil that they all died in. And that is the latest, well, I say it's the latest, it's 6 months old now, that we've been trying to negotiate. The Porthcawl Town Council were very, very enamoured with it, and everybody there seemed extremely pleased with it. We did the same presentation to the cabinet in BCBC, and something was very different there. It just didn't go down at all well. And it's still not doing very well as far as they're concerned. So, what's new? So, going back a bit, if you've got any questions, I'd be pleased to answer them.
Thank you very much, Gary. Are there any questions? Thanks.
I had the privilege to speak to people who are actually in the attempted rescue. And what's not been stressed enough, not in your talk, but in generally, is the atrocious weather that night. It was so bad, they said they couldn't keep on their feet. They had to go on all hands and knees. And also they were firing short harpoons with lines attached to them, and they were blowing back. And the other thing I heard was, two things I heard. And number one, afterwards is always an accurate thought. Number one is, had they stayed in the forward part of the engine and ship on the rocks, they'd have been safe when it abated next day. But this is what I was going to ask you. I read a couple of accounts, and it says that she had got rid of her ballast, because she needed high water to get into Newport. And she hung outside Newport, and she got rid of her ballast. She put one anchor down up forward, and then the other anchor down up forward, and attempted to use the engine with the two chains to try and hold course until the water was sufficient for her to go in. But she'd lost so much balance that only half the prop was in the water, so she had no propulsion. And consequently, one line snapped, the other snapped, she came back down channel and across.
Right.
Is that your experience?
I've not heard that story. As far as the communications is concerned, it says, I've just got a fallen point abeam of me, and I'm heaving too. There's nothing about going further up to Cardiff. Of course, the pilots were from Barry Rhodes, and really they would be governing traffic up to Cardiff and Newport, etc. Personally, I don't think it got that far. The appointment with the Barry Rhodes pilots kept moving back and back and never took place, as far as I'm aware. The weather on the night or the afternoon, shall we say, Alan Edwards TV was up there as a boy, and he will tell you that, you know, what people don't appreciate in a storm near the sea is there's an awful lot of spray coming along off the tops of the sea, and if you're within a mile or two of it, you are getting sandblasted with spray, so you can't see, your visibility is cut right down. You can't stand up because of the force of the wind, and there's this spray of a mixture of sea and oil getting over you. The Coast Guards did fire 3 rockets, and they promptly went back over their heads into the field. They couldn't take the equipment, which was pretty cumbersome, I understand, because of the flatness of the plateau there brings the sea right up. And so although they could see the ship, they couldn't get to it, etc. So yes, and of course there is Alan.
I just wanted to say, can you hear me?
Yeah. Right.
I just wanted to say, the night of the Samtampa, I was 16 years of age.
All right.
And we had gone down into Porthcawl because we always went Saturday to the pavilion dance. There was always a dance on the Saturday. And we went in and we dudley dancing. Then all of a sudden there were terrific noises. And we ran upstairs and went out on the balcony. And there was all the fire things, flares and everything going. The whole sky was absolutely lit up. I've never seen anything like it before. Difficult to describe because it was like there was, you could, it was like you were right in the scary beach, you know, everything was so near and real, even though it was scary and that was a civilian. But we had a very good view from the balcony. We were all very frightened and everything about them. And I just thought I'd share that.
Why, thank you. Yeah, I mean, that does tie up because all the convoys, after the first year or so, carried what they call star shells, but they were like big fireworks basically, and they lit up the area for miles around actually. So that could have been part of the equipment that the Samtampa still had on board. Yes.
Not so much a question as a suggestion. It says trouble getting the memorial, and the anniversary is next year, you say?
Well, the 70th anniversary, there was a 60th anniversary, mm-hmm. which I went to purely as a spectator. I had nothing at all to do with the organisation. And there's a 70th one, obviously, coming up now next April. Yeah. I'm presuming there'll be an 80th after.
I mean, you three aren't pleased to go, but I'm sure a lot of you three members would support me. If Shout organise a petition to encourage the building and presentation of the memorial, that might help.
Yes, it's a very good suggestion, and yes, anything that we could do ourselves to help would be good. Mm-hmm.
I don't think I need that. So, you can hear me, can't you?
Yes, we can, yeah.
Basically, two things, Harry.
Right.
As far as your memorial, I'm all in favour of that memorial. I think we may have had this message before, but 10 years ago, in preparation for the commemoration of the 60th anniversary, the lions cleaned the beach.
Yes, that's right.
And we cleaned the area where the memorial was. I have only once, in God knows how many times, walking past it, looked for it since. And a very useful thing that you could do with a couple of quid's worth of memorial money would be to put a plaque on the wall telling me that I'm now in front of the memorial. So anyway, the other thing that's a knock on from that was that it was the start of beach cleaning.
Right.
It became quite a big thing, which the Lions and lots of other people have got involved in ever since, but beach cleaning in this area took quite a big step forward with the 10th anniversary. So I hope we do something equally useful with the 70th.
Thank you, Andrew. I should also explain there are other memorials in Porthcawl. In All Saints Church, there's a 12 by 10 inch memorial set in the wall in All Saints Church. And of course, we've got the mass grave in the cemetery as well, which some people think is a memorial as well. But really, what we're about is that other than the people probably in this room and people like us, if you went to John Street and you ask any 20, 30, 40-year-old what you know about the Samtampa, they would look at you probably in amazement as to never heard of it. And that's part of our maritime heritage as far as I'm concerned. I certainly think our heritage should be protected by the people who are paid to protect it. And therefore, I think what we have to do is to show them this is Porthcawl's heritage. And come on, guys, you have heritage officers both in the Welsh Government, both in the borough councils of this world. Why, if you go up any valleys, and I don't want to make any comparisons, but there's lots of heritage sites in any valley for the pit pursuer, the pit was there, this was that, whatever. Jeanette comes from St. Enid, and we know it's quite an elaborate memorial up there. And maritime heritage seems to be something that goes under the looking glass or whatever. It's not really sort of noticed, and we really need to focus on something. And this might be it.
Mm-hmm. My father was in St. John's Ambulance, and that night he was called down with other St. John's Ambulance to protect the bodies on the beach.
Yes, yes, yeah. Well, just what that lady was saying that about the bodies on the beach, I mean, it's not very nice to be in a violent storm with breakers floating round. And the 12 people who are buried in Porthcawl, and I've got a lot of records here, which show that they could not be identified. And on the grave, which, you know, I've been to following up various areas in this, and the registry in the grave book for the cemetery just guesses the ages. So male 30 to 40 is in the entries because they could not be recognized as such. I mean, obviously the Mumbers crew were easy. The captain was a New Zealander. He was buried in Porthcawl in the cemetery as well, but his wife had him exhumed. And I've got a photocopy of the cremation in Glyntaf the following year. What I haven't found out is where his ashes went to, because the undertakers weren't recorded in those days. They are today, but it wasn't there. So he was from Wellington. We've been in touch with people in Wellington in the Welsh pub there, and we hope to find out where his ashes. But there was a bit of a family dispute, and so it's not too easy to follow that particular route.
I wonder if I can just pick up from what Rex said as well. Just following the charted voyage of the Samtampa, Gary, came from Middlesbrough. So it was running down the east coast of England, along the south coast, where presumably the weather was still all right.
That's right.
And then as it turned into the channel, it would have passed. What happened in that track as it turned presumably into the channel? I'm presuming it was north, it must have passed us at one time north of Porthcawl, is that right? On the Devon coast, I think, to come into Newport. What happened in that journey at that time? That's one point. And secondly, could I just ask you about the lifeboat? What was the attitude of the helmsman and the captain? Did they think they had a chance when they went out in those conditions?
Dealing with the lifeboat crew first, children, if you like, of the victims and the lifeboat crew itself said that my father didn't want to go or this or that, and there were indications that this was a suicide mission, if you like, and there was a lot. I'm not saying that William Gammon, I mean, some of these people just are fearless, and I suppose if you put your name down for that, you've got to be somewhat fearless yourself. But there was reservations then, possibly is one way of the size of the storm. It was a lot of time lost because the boat, we all know the Mumbles slipway, the boat came down, but they didn't know the Santampa's position, so they had to come back to the slipway, and through Addisland were given the position of it. But the ship was breaking up, and I don't see it was any possible to get near them without wrecking your own ship. So, and to deal with your other point, the barometer was dropping as it came up around Cornwall and around the North Devon coast, and it says in its radio message, just passing this, whatever. And then the captain radios that he's decided to heave to. Obviously, the barometer was dropping, the gale was getting worse, nobody knew where it was. I mean, we weren't so advanced in those days as to forecasting the strength of it. And he obviously didn't want the radio conversations about the pilot meeting the pilot. There was it's a management sort of decision. So I've agreed to meet the pilot at this certain time, and so I want to keep to that. So he kept pushing it, but obviously, once the storm got to a certain area, he realised he was getting landlocked, and it's best stay out and call it all off. And to my mind, that looks about the best scenario, was that he decided, hang on, there's not an awful lot of room around here. This gale is getting worse and worse. I better stop, and that's what he did. It'd be better if he'd gone back out, probably.
The only point I wanted to make, and Gary and I have talked about this before, I mean, I remember not being able to see out of the windows of our house in Port Talbot the next day because it was covered in oil. And Carol, most of you would know my first wife, Carol's father was the policeman in charge of the police on the beach on the night, and developed double pneumonia and nearly died as a result of it. But there was one thing that I was telling Gary. I was talking to Adrian in Fox's hairdressers on Station Hill, and he said that his father ran away to sea when he was 14 and they threw him back because he was too small. But he then joined the merchant when he was 16 and sailed with the line that owned the Samtampa. And for one reason or another, when they came back from a particular voyage, the last main voyage it had done, he was sent down to Milford Haven to come back to Bristol on a sister ship. And nobody altered the manifest. So the day after the tragedy, his mother had a telegram to say that he'd been drowned at sea. And 2 days later, he walked in.
Oh, God.
So I think most people of an age know something about it. Another fellow I was talking to, his father carried all the bodies back up from the beach in his flat top truck. But there's a tremendous amount of knowledge out there if you can actually get people to talk about it.
That's right.
And Gary mentioned one other thing, and that is, of course, the Welsh Government. It's their Year of the Sea, I believe, next year, isn't it?
2018, yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, there are reasons to do this. Anyway, thank you.
Well, we, as David knows, our patron is, in fact, Karen Jones. Now we know he's a busy guy and he's got an awful lot to think of other than Samtampa and maybe helping us with BCBC, but I'm sure that question will be sort of resolved fairly soon. Now.
Are there any more questions?
Okay.
No. Well, I'd like to thank Gary ever so much. He's obviously done a terrific amount of work on this to get a presentation like that. I must admit, I hadn't realised that if a ship is torpedoed, a lot of the time it does survive. And the thought of welding two halves together again, because you can, never struck me, to be honest. Thanks very much. Absolutely excellent talk. Can we show our appreciation of the usual?